to.
New Testament, the book of Luke,
5th chapter, verses 1 through 5. New Testament, book of Luke, 5th chapter, verses 1 through 5. You have it, say amen.
Amen. Same Luke, the 5th chapter, starting the first verse. And it came to pass.
And it came to pass.
That as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God.
That as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God.
He saw by the lake of
Gennesaret. Yes, good.
And saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them. And were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships.
And he entered into one of the ships.
Which was Simon's.
Yes.
And prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship.
Yes.
Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep.
Launch out into the deep.
And let down your nets for a draw. Verse 5.
Yes.
And Simon answered and said unto him, Master,
yes.
We have toiled all night.
We have toiled all night.
And have taken nothing.
And have caught nothing.
Nevertheless.
Nevertheless.
At thy word, I will let down the net.
At thy word, I will let down the net. And the church says,
amen.
Father, we thank you for the reading and hearing of thy word. Lord, it's settled in our hearts and in our spirits. We love you and we count it done. In Jesus' name we pray, our souls say, amen. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Your blessings.
Your blessings.
Is in your in obeying.
Your blessings.
Is in obeying. Your blessings are in obeying. Your blessings is in obeying. Your blessings. My blessings. Tell your names and name.
Neighbor.
Your blessings are there too.
Your blessings are there too.
Obey. Obedience is one of the key components that it seems like is difficult for one to do. We can do a whole lot of things. Put a man up on the moon. Take a spaceship and shoot it off the ground, put it up in the sky. We can do a whole lot of feats and a whole lot of strange and spectacular things. But some kind of way it seems like it's difficult just to simply obey. Now, if the truth be told, Adam named everything. Call those things, and they had received those names, had authority over the garden, everything that was around, and all he had to do was to obey God. And we find in some kind of way, him and Eve disobeyed God. We see two passages of scripture here, one in Genesis in the Old Testament, the father of faith, Abraham. We see that he had received some instructions that we didn't actually go into all the text to see what the instructions were, but God was telling him to go to a place. And when God told him to go to this particular place, he was going to, at that point, sacrifice his son, Isaac. And Abraham packed his stuff up and got his son and a couple of people with him and just went until he saw the place where God had instructed him to go. And when he finally saw the place, an act of obedience, Abraham told the young men to stay here. While me and the lad, we go further, and we go on to worship God. Abraham's instructions of obedience in his mindset was going to worship God. And you know, and I know, in the Old Testament time is when they were bringing sacrifices to before God. Abraham was an individual that was from a group of individuals that believe in sacrificing their children. We find that in this particular text, Abraham heard the voice of God, and God was speaking to him, giving him instructions. And when Abraham and his son went up on the mountain, they built the altar just like God instructed him. And they took his son and tied his son to the altar. Now it's clear to me that his son wasn't a little baby, because his son helped carry the womb. And his son was able to talk, tell his father, you know, I see the altar, I see the wood, I see the fire, I see all of this, I see the knife. Where is the sacrifice?
Right.
What are we going to use to sacrifice before God? Because he heard his father tell the guys at the foot of the mountain that me and my father were going up on the mountain to worship. There was no doubt in my mind that his son knew what worship was all about, knew that it required a sacrifice. Somebody say sacrifice.
Sacrifice.
Many times in our sacrifice, we want to just tip God. Hello, somebody. Want to give God a tip. You know, that's what I call it, a tip. You know, not, we don't want to pay, do the whole full thing, just give him a tip. We don't want to be obedient to him. So we see that Abraham was obedient to God to the letter. He got his son and tied his son down to the altar. And I don't know why he tied him down. You know, if the son was not a little kid, somebody help me here. Big enough to carry the wood up there. First of all, my thought would be, how did the son get on the altar? Obviously, the son was obedient. Huh? He was obedient. And it ain't hard to understand that this particular text in this scenario here with Abraham and his son give you a snapshot of Jesus and the Father. Jesus was obedient to the Father. We know John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Mm-hmm. The difference is this lad didn't die. He was destined to die, but he didn't die. Now, there's a lot of theory behind why he didn't die, why he didn't go all the way through, Abraham didn't go all the way through with the sacrifice, because God had something already prepared, amen, for a sacrifice. Because we couldn't use Isaac as the sacrifice, because Isaac was a snapshot of Jesus. And if we had used Isaac and had actually killed him, then he would have been the sacrifice instead of Jesus. And there is no substitute. Somebody help me here. I just want you to understand, you can't give God a substitute. You can't even go into scripture and show where God used a substitute. Somebody help me. Somebody said, well, the ram was a substitute. No, the ram wasn't the son. The ram wasn't the son. Isaac was the son, which gives a snapshot of the father and the son, amen, in an act of sacrificing for, amen, things that are wrong, or sin, if you please. So, that was Genesis. And finally, at the end of this particular text, as we continue to go into it, we find that when Abraham was fully engaged with the knife ready to plunge into his son, God spoke to him. Let me tell you something. It's important for us to hear God's voice. Because we can be in the midst of doing something that God told us to do, and God can tell us to turn in the midst of what we're doing. And if you're not in tune with God, you will miss what you have for you. They can hear that Abraham, how the blessings of the Lord was pronounced from his obedience. And Abraham, being the father of faith, stepping out and doing what God had said, put him in a category now that the blessings of God are going to flow upon his life. Not just him, but from generations on. We see that in the next scripture in the book of Luke, we see that it talks about fishermen, how that Jesus was there. And when Jesus was there ministering, the crowd sort of pressed him. Somebody say press. And sometimes we don't really understand the scriptures until we get understanding from somebody. Yes. And that's why the scripture said, how can you hear without a preacher? And you've been home and you sat down and you read your Bible and you didn't understand a thing. I wish I had somebody who was real.
Amen.
Sit up there lying to me. I know sometimes you read that word and you read and read and read and it's like, what was I doing? Seems like you don't have no revelation, no understanding. You know what the words were, but you don't understand what was going on.
Right.
And the next thing you know, you come to church and God opens your understanding to you. Just like that. Let me tell you about this particular text. This particular text had these fishermen. And these fishermen had just finished a regiment of fishing. And here in this day and time, they didn't have fishing poles, they had nets. And they had was out washing their nets because they were fishing all night. But the text tell me that they didn't catch anything. Which lets me know, amen, that you can do something for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
You can do it all night long.
Right.
But if you don't catch anything,
right,
you don't have anything. And I want to just keep this in the front of your mind that your blessing is in obeying.
Amen.
Abraham was blessed because he obeyed God. Mm-hmm. And these fishermen didn't catch anything, but they had Jesus with them. Mm-hmm. And when they had Jesus with them, we find that they had to get understanding. And in Proverbs, I believe it says, in all thy getting, get some understanding. Somebody help me in this way. Help me preach this thing. Understanding will cause you to take action. When you understand what you're supposed to do, you're going to take some action. You're going to do something. You may step out of it. It may be just a little bit strange, but you're going to step out and you're going to do that thing. Mm-hmm. And when you have the lack of understanding or being ignorant about something, you will be hesitant, amen, about doing it. I said something in Bible class before last, and I think it's worth repeating. I think I'm going to stand on this for a long time until somebody proves me wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you know how to do something and you don't do it for the Lord,
right?
I said that means you don't want to do it.
Amen.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Something similar to that. And when you do it, amen, that means you will it. You know what I mean? In other words, if you know how to sing and you don't sing, that means you don't want to sing. You know how, amen, to usher and you don't want to usher. Huh? That means you don't want to usher. Huh? So I'm going to stand on when you know your gift and you don't operate in it. You simply don't want to. Now you can't go to work and tell folks I don't want to do it.
Right.
And stay on that job.
Amen.
I don't feel like driving today. You don't feel like that. You came to work today, didn't you? Yeah. But how you think the kids gonna get picked up?
Right.
You got a school bus. Yeah. I don't feel like. You get my picture? The guy that's driving on the lady that's driving the school bus don't feel like driving today. Go to work, to work and to get paid, but don't feel like it. Can you imagine what happens to that trade? That person gonna lose their job. Huh? Because you don't feel like it.
Amen.
Church is no different. Huh? When God has anointed you to do a job, amen, he wants to advance the kingdom through what you do. Look at these individuals that had understanding and those that didn't have understanding. And in Luke, I believe it is the first verse that says that it came to pass that as the people pressed, somebody say pressed, and they pressed upon Jesus, amen, to hear the word of God. They wasn't pressing Jesus for a miracle. They were pressing to get the word of God. And you got to understand that we need the word of God in this day and time. We're living in dangerous times where so much stuff is going on that you can't even name all the craziness that's going on.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, it's crazy stuff. I mean crazy. We on our way to church this morning and talk about some crazy stuff. And I'm saying to myself, Jesus, we some kind of way, we done missed it. we had missed it somehow. Way.
Right.
You know, we were talking about this crazy, I think it's crazy, this TV show, this guy, these people that's supposed to be, I can't even say it, Jesus. Anyway. And they're going to go to somebody and talk, they're going to come there for the church and confess that they live in sin, but, you know, follow me.
Yeah.
Now, my grandchildren may not like church. They may not like the things that go on in church. But they never will ever be able to say they came to their grandfather's church and he told them stuff that wasn't in the word of God.
That's right.
You never hear me come up here and say you can have all this stuff and still be saved. How am I going to be a homosexual and still be preaching to you?
Come on now.
I'm telling you, these people were pressing God. They were pressing Jesus to get the word. And Minister Dye, when I looked at this scripture, I said, wow. Let's not talk about the nets. Let's talk about the word of God. Because it was the word of God that the people wanted. Now, I had the experience of brushing my teeth this morning. Y'all looking at me like, duh. You know, when I have to pray for somebody, they gonna smell my breath if I don't. Hello. Amen. And one of the things, Pam, that I was, you know, all week long, I'm going to the store to get toothpaste. And today is Sunday, and I haven't been to the store yet. And the toothpaste container had toothpaste in it, but in order for me to get it out, I had to. I wish I had somebody in here. I look at this press now, it's a little different. These people were pressing Jesus. Press is not always a bad thing. I look at this press now as a good thing because you ought to be pressed to get the word of God out of somebody. And when we look at this text, not only where did they have understanding, but the people that pressed Jesus in Luke, we find that this good thing, I look at it all together different now. Because when Jesus in Luke, he got into these other two ships that were there. These guys that were fishing all night, that were washing their nets, Jesus got into one of the ships. And the Bible said that the ship that he got in belonged to Simon Peter. And when he got into Simon's ship, Jesus sat down and taught the people, amen, from out of the ship. And we find that many times when we get to the place where we're going to be taught, amen, we really don't get it. I heard it in Sunday school, but I heard somebody else in Sunday school too, amen, that just shared with us about how important it is, amen, to get the word of God. It's more important for you to get the word of God than it is to get a shout here. Somebody help me in this way. Now, you should not sit dry all your Christian life. Hello, somebody. You ought to get a shout in every now and then. Your hand ought to go up every next, some kind of. You gotta have, listen, anything that's got life in it ought to move sometime. I wish I had somebody in it. You know what I'm talking about. Somebody said, well, this is what do you want? You want me to be a dead church or a live church? I'd rather you be alive with the word. Somebody help me in this place. When you go to school, we got to begin to open up our mouth and tell folks about Jesus. You go on your job, you got to tell folks about Jesus. Now, there will be some that don't want to hear you. Amen. Those that don't want to hear you, shake the dust off their feet. Keep on going. But when you get an opportunity to talk about Jesus, you need to turn your volume up. I wish I had somebody to say something to you. Well, let's look at these guys that were fishing. And these guys, Jesus was in the boat. We see that these guys, after they washed their net, they brought the nets back to the boat. And they put them back on the ship. Amen. And I said, wow, my God. Seems like, you know, if we as a church, and we just casting our nets, and we not catching anything. Amen. Souls are not being brought in. Something is wrong somewhere. Huh? We fish all night and don't catch nothing. There's something wrong somewhere. Amen. Stop saying you haven't caught anything and obey whatever God has told you to do. Launch on out into the deep. I take note to that because it's interesting that he told them to cast his net on the other side. What I take note to, Mr. Frazier, is Jesus never spoke to the fish.
Amen.
Now, once do you read in the scripture that Jesus spoke to the fish?
Amen.
He only spoke to the disciples that were fishing.
Right.
The fishermen. He spoke to the fishermen and told them, listen, you so used to casting your net over here, cast it on the other side.
Amen.
Now, the fishermen probably had reasons for casting the net the way that they did. Hello? Hello? All you right-handers, give me a wave. You got a reason why you write with your right hand. Hello, somebody. And so the fishermen, well, no, I don't believe the lefties out. Oh, you left wrong hands, raise your hand. If you right handed, you're right. If you wrong handed, they still right with the right hand, wrong hand. I mean, y'all. Got me over here trying to write me a letter. But she said you should write with both of them. You want them. Oh, you both had them. Well, anyway, the disciples, they were still operating, amen, in their custom, in their tradition. But Jesus had to change that tradition and give them a word. He gave them a word. And the word that he gave them, he said, cast the net on the other side. He didn't talk to the fish, he talked to the fisherman. And the fisherman said, okay, we threw the net on the other side. Even though we towed all night, we didn't catch anything, when they threw it on the other side, the blessings of the Lord overflowed them. They had so many fish that they had to call other ships to help them. Amen. Pull the fish in, pull the nets in. And I'm convinced, if they were obedient to God's word, I'm convinced, if you be obedient to God's word, he'll cause your nets to overflow. He'll cause your boat to overflow. He'll cause your life to be changed. Come on, somebody. Come in this place. Yeah, when God overflow in your life, you got to understand, you got to obey God. As we obey God, he will take us further down the road. Yes, he will. Sometimes you don't want to obey. You don't feel like obeying. Amen. Doesn't seem like you should obey. You did it all night. You haven't caught anything. I'm tired. I'm ready to go home. Somebody help me in this place. But if you go a little further and just give God some glory. Come on here. Go a little further and cast that net on the other side. You didn't catch anything on this side? Cast it on the other side. Amen. Learn how to give God glory in spite of what you got to go through here. Amen. There is obedience. If you're obedient in God, you obey God. Amen. His word is not going to return void, but it's going to accomplish therein where you please. Somebody's in this place and somebody don't know Jesus as their Savior. You that are in here, I want you to do this for me. I want you to make me aware.